Well, thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much for the invitation to come to Riverside. I've had a really great day here. The work which I'm going to talk about was done by Osman Karaman. Oh, wow. I think that's better, right? Yeah. Thank you. who's a postdoc in my group, and Dee Lee, who is a graduate student. And we've also benefited enormously here from collaborations with Bill Klug over at UCLA and with Ned Wingreen at Princeton. Now, before actually getting into the details of this research, I just want to spend at least a couple of minutes trying to give you a feeling for the overall theme of this talk and for the kind of research which we're doing in my group. So what you see on the left-hand side here is sort of a contemporary cartoon of what biologists think a cell membrane looks like. And this is a cartoon, but it's actually a cartoon based on an enormous amount of experimental data. And in a sense, what we are doing as theoretical physicists working in biology is to take these sorts of cartoons, translate them into the language of physics, with the aim of uncovering the basic physical mechanisms and principles driving a particular set of biological phenomena. Now, for the purposes of this talk, there are two features of this cartoon that will become very important. The first one is that membrane proteins, so these are these blobs here, are generally expected to deform the surrounding lipid bilayer membrane. Secondly, cell membranes are crowded with membrane proteins, with the typical separation between two membrane proteins being of the same order of magnitude as the size of a protein. So in general, these protein-induced bilayer deformations will overlap, and you can already imagine that perhaps membrane proteins will be able to interact with each other through the intervening lipid bilayer membrane and through these deformations. Now, what's not really shown in this cartoon here is that we now know a lot about the structure of membrane proteins. In particular, we know that membrane proteins come in distinct shapes and symmetries. And indeed, one of the themes of this talk will be to see to what extent the shape and symmetry of a membrane protein is reflected in the structure of the protein-induced lipid bilayer deformations, and then in turn, how these non-trivial deformation profiles can actually influence the biological function of membrane proteins. Now, over the last 15 years or so, there has been enormous experimental progress in the quantitative characterization of cell membranes through the development of techniques such as super-resolution light microscopy and electron cryotomography. And what this has shown is that many of the key biological functions of cell membranes do not follow in some straightforward manner from the structure of individual isolated membrane proteins, but rather emerge from protein structure together with interactions between a protein and the surrounding lipid bilayer membrane, as well as between many proteins in the cell membrane. And so in other words, we're dealing with collective phenomena, right? And in a sense, what I will do in this talk here is to try to give you a couple of examples of such collective membrane phenomena and how we can think about these sorts of collective membrane phenomena from the perspective of physics. So, in fact, the first sort of very important class of collective membrane phenomena relates to the regulation of membrane shape during, for instance, endocytosis, so the vesiculation of little membrane vesicles. And we're going to look at this in the context of what are called membrane protein polyhedral nanoparticles. I will explain in a minute what those actually are. A second important example of a collective membrane phenomenon is the regulation of protein function through the surrounding lipid bilayer membrane. We're going to think about this in the context of mechanosensitive ion channels a little bit later on in the talk. Finally, a third example of a collective membrane phenomenon is the self-assembly of membrane proteins into sort of regular two-dimensional lattices in the cell membrane. And we're going to think about this on the one hand in the context of mechanosensitive ion channels, but at least if there's enough time, I'm also going to say a few words about this in the context of what are called chemoreceptor lattices. Now, I should emphasize that all of these aspects of collective membrane function are, of course, very much interrelated. So in general, to generate different types of non-trivial curvature, one needs ordering of membrane proteins. Similarly, the ordering of membrane protein can, in fact, be very sensitive to membrane shape and membrane geometry. So in general, there's really an interplay between all of these different effects here. OK, so first of all, let's think about membrane protein polyhedral nanoparticles. So the motivation for this specific work really comes from membrane protein structural biology. So as at least some of you might be aware of, in the last 25 years or so, there have been several breakthroughs in membrane protein structural biology. And we now have the structures of hundreds of distinct membrane proteins. Now, what is usually done here from an experimental perspective is that one removes the membrane protein from its lipid bilayer environment in a cell membrane, embeds it into what is called a protein detergent complex, and with some luck, one can then crystallize these complexes well enough that one can use a synchrotron to say something about the atomic resolution structure of the membrane protein. So again, this has been enormously successful, these techniques of protein crystallography, but it's also well known that this approach has several shortcomings. First of all, what one is actually interested in, of course, is the structure of the membrane protein within its native in vivo lipid bilayer environment, right? And in general, it is not clear that the two structures are really the same. Obviously, we do a very drastic perturbation to the system here. The other issue is a somewhat more subtle one. So from a biological perspective, one is very often not so much interested in just one structure of a given membrane protein, but in fact, one is interested in different structures of a given membrane protein in different conformational states of the protein. Now, very often, these different conformational states are in fact stabilized and driven by transmembrane gradients. And of course, once one doesn't actually have a membrane anymore, it is not clear how one can even think about setting up such a transmembrane gradient. And so over the last couple of years, actually one or two or three years, electron cryotomography has sort of emerged as a very sort of exciting technique and possibility for actually overcoming these traditional limitations of protein crystallography. And a very interesting step in this direction was made a couple of years ago, I think, by Doug Rees at Caltech, Michael Stowell at UC Boulder and their collaborators, who observed the self-assembly of what they called membrane protein polyhedral nanoparticles. And in order to save a little bit of time, I'm going to refer to these membrane protein polyhedral nanoparticles as MPPNs from now on. So what are MPPNs? So MPPNs are closed lipid bilayer vesicles composed of a lipid bilayer and several membrane proteins. We can think about them as kind of little balloons. Now, MPPNs have the important property that they have a well-defined characteristic size of about 20 nanometers. And moreover, the arrangement of the proteins in these MPPNs is not random, but they're arranged according to polyhedral symmetry. In particular, in these experiments, they used a membrane protein called the mechanosensitive channel of small conductance, or MSCS. And for this particular membrane protein, what they observed was the snap cube symmetry. So that's kind of the symmetry of the arrangement of the membrane proteins here. That's a snap cube, with the idea being that on each vertex of the snap cube, there sits one of these particular proteins called MSCS. Okay, and that's sort of a pretty rough sort of 3D, still pretty rough data, sort of a 3D reconstruction of these electron cryotomography images that they obtained. So you're looking at the surface of the MPPN here. Superimposed now is the structure, or the different is the structure of the membrane protein MSCS they used here, which is known from protein crystallography. And so you can see that the proximate surface of the membrane protein is resolved, and they also resolve smaller scale features of the protein, such as these cavities inside of the protein. But of course, this is not atomic scale resolution. Okay, so let me just quickly sort of summarize the key experimental features of MPPNs that are going to be important for this talk. So first of all, these MPPNs, they were found to self-assemble in vitro in an aqueous environment, for those of you who know about viruses, very similar to sort of viral capsid self-assembly. Importantly, the proteins in these MPPNs are embedded in a lipid bilayer environment. And since MPPNs are closed, there is a notion of inside and outside, right? And so you could think about setting up some transmembrane gradient of chemicals or ions or whatever, and hence actually through these transmembrane gradients, for instance, opening up one of these channels here, trapping the channel in the open conformational state. Now, from the perspective of using these MPPNs for structural studies, the important features are that MPPNs have a well-defined symmetry and a well-defined characteristic size. So again, for these particular proteins and lipids used in these experiments, the symmetry was found to be the symmetry of a snap cube, one protein on each of the 24 vertices, and the size was, the characteristic overall radius was found to be approximately 20 nanometers. Now, as mentioned, the resolution is not that great at the moment, so it's kind of a 1 nanometer resolution in these electron cryotomography experiments. And one of the key problems here, one of the key limitations, is that experimentally it's currently not possible to really exert control over the symmetry and size of MPPNs. So it's kind of very hard to optimize these parameters. And exactly sort of having a well-defined symmetry and well-defined size of MPPNs is essential for improving the resolution.
So they always have threefold symmetry, the protein itself.
What do you mean with threefold symmetry?
Oh. Uh-huh.
Yeah, so you know on this face, right, it's actually a square, and in this face it's a triangle, right? So it's sort of both. The protein itself has, I think, an eightfold symmetry, if I remember correctly. It's an Archimedean solid. So you actually, so the cube is a platonic solid, right? So you actually make a snap cube by translating the faces of the cube outwards and filling up the intervening space with equilateral triangles. So it's actually a chiral Archimedean solid. Yeah. Okay, so. Yeah, so that's, you know, these are the particular experiments they did with this particular protein, these particular lipids, and that's what they found, right? Mm-hmm.
But if you change the protein,
the membrane protein, you might find something. Yes, I mean, so these were really the first experiments on that, right? So there isn't like an extensive experimental literature, but that's certainly expected, and based on the theory, which I'm gonna tell you about, we certainly expect this to happen too. Okay, so it's actually a very good interlude. So. Sort of the key things which kind of caught our curiosity here is that, first of all, how does this self-assembly of MPPNs actually happen? I mean, what actually are the physical mechanisms that yield MPPN self-assembly? And then if we understand that, can we actually say something about the key molecular properties of the particular lipids and the particular proteins that are used here that actually set the observed symmetry and the observed size of MPPNs? Yes? Do they assemble without the membrane? No. Yes, absolutely. So the proteins, they don't bind to each other. They actually repel each other. So they repel each other through protein-protein interaction. Through the membrane, right, there might be some membrane-mediated interaction which attracts them. But as far as the protein-protein interaction is concerned, they would not find like a viral, like a shell, like for a viral capsid, for instance. Yeah, so that's what I'm going to tell you about. That's exactly sort of the question which we are trying to address, right? What actually defines it? But I can tell you, let me return to this in a minute. okay, so over the last few years, we've been sort of going back and forth with the experiments to exactly address these questions here, right? And so what I'm going to tell you about next is sort of the simplest physical model which seems to capture these experiments very well, actually. And so in the simplest model, in this minimal analytic, in fact, a mean field type model, we consider two key contributions to the MPPN energy. The first one is a fairly obvious one. So if one looks at the observed structure of MSCS, these particular membrane proteins used here, it turns out to have a very good approximation, a conical shape. Now, these conical membrane inclusions have been studied in great detail over the years, and it is known that conical membrane proteins induce curvature deformations in the surrounding lipid bilayer membrane. At least in the simplest picture, the energy cost of these curvature deformations can be described by the famous Helfrich energy, where, so this is just written here in the very simple Monge representation, but it can also be written more generally, of course, where this term here corresponds to the mean curvature of the surface, right? And KB is simply the bending rigidity of the lipid bilayer membrane. Now, in our case, right, we actually have many of these membrane proteins embedded in a spherical lipid bilayer vesicle in MPPN. And in fact, a very similar problem was studied a couple of years ago by Thomas Out and Gerhard Gomper in the context of budding. And what they actually argued and found was that from an energetic perspective, the optimal arrangement of these proteins on the curved surface would be a perfect hexagonal lattice. And if one approximates the unit cell of the hexagonal lattice by a circle, then one can obtain a very, very, very simple energy for a very simple expression for the energy cost of protein-induced curvature deformations in MPPNs, simply by minimizing this Helfrich energy. And so, of course, the important issue here concerns the boundary condition. So we minimize this energy over an annulus surrounding the membrane protein. And there are two different types of boundary conditions. In the inner part of the annulus, we have boundary conditions dictated by the particular protein we are talking about, in particular dictated by the protein radius, Ri, and the bilayer protein contact angle, alpha. On the outer part of the annulus, we have boundary conditions that are dictated by the overall shape of MPPNs, in particular the MPPN radius, R, and the number of proteins per MPPN, little n. Okay, so these are the two different sets of boundary conditions, and we minimize this energy. We obtain this analytic expression here, which depends on these parameters, and also depends on Kb. Again, Kb is a lipid property. For these particular lipids that were used in these experiments on MPPNs, Kb has been measured in various experiments and is approximately equal to 14 kBT. Okay? So that's part of the story here. And to come back to Royer's question, of course, we could think about how could we actually pack these conical inclusions together without a membrane, right? So if there are actually attractive protein-protein interactions between the different conical inclusions, we could simply ask, well, can we construct an MPPN from that? And it turns out that if you do that, you would actually expect about 17 proteins per MPPN, which turns out to be not the case, right? So there's actually, the actual number is 24, right? And indeed, the membrane is very much essential for that. Okay, so that's part of the story here, right? But we also know that, in fact, it's impossible to form to form a perfect hexagonal lattice on the sphere, right, for topological reasons. And in fact, to quantify the energy cost of these topological defects, we borrow a formalism that was actually developed a couple of years ago by Royer together with Robin Brownsman and their collaborators in the context of viral capsid self-assembly. And so the idea here is to consider what is known as the Thomas problem. So that refers to the fraction of the surface of a sphere enclosed by n identical non-overlapping circles at closest packing. So I'm going to call this P of n. So the upper limit on P of n is provided by a perfect hexagonal lattice. So this is P max. But as mentioned, because we are living on a sphere here on these MPPNs, we necessarily need to introduce these topological defects. And depending on the number of proteins per MPPN, little n, we then obtain different packing fractions, different optimal packing fractions. For instance, one particularly favorable state is n equals 12, right, which corresponds to the symmetry of a perfect arrangement corresponding to the icosahedron. Now, for our purposes, what this difference between P max, the hexagonal lattice, and P of n, the actual packing fraction, allows us to do is to actually quantify how far away we are from perfect hexagonal packing. And that way, we can estimate the energy cost of these defects in the arrangement of the proteins on MPPNs. Right, so these are the two key contributions to the MPPN energy. We can then certainly simply add them up, right, and minimize them for each n with respect to r, so with respect to the MPPN radius. Right, and if we do that, we obtain an energy curve for the total MPPN energy of this form here. There's a lot going on here, so I just want to... What do you mean, what are the defects?
So you're putting in defects, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, it's not like a pentagon.
Yeah, so the defect... So the defects are in terms of the number of nearest neighbors of each protein, right? So the ideal situation would be 6 nearest neighbors, right? And what I'm saying is that, so the actual number is going to depend on the number of proteins that are forming the MPPN, right? And it's going to be dependent on that, right? So it can be 5 for an icosahedron, or it can be something else, right? But that's dictated by topology at the end of the day, right? Okay, so this total MPPN energy, right? So there's a lot going on here, so I just want to point out the two key features. The first one is that there's actually a lower cutoff on n. So for very small n, it becomes energetically very unfavorable to form an MPPN. And actually, the physical reason for that has to do with the energy cost of protein-induced curvature deformations. Right? That's one aspect. And if we actually use the particular parameters, protein size and the bilayer protein contact angle suggested by the structure of MSCS, this particular protein used in these experiments, this cutoff falls at around n equals 20. The other feature is that in a large n regime, we obtain these series of local minima, which correspond to locally optimal packing states. But if you look at the energy scale here, the minima are together in energy by just 1 or 2 kBT maximum, right? And what this actually tells us is that thermal effects are going to be very important in this regime here because the thermal energy scale is of that order. Now, before actually talking about the thermal effects here, I just want to do a very, very quick detour and say a few words about sort of a complementary viewpoint, which again is actually inspired by work done by Roy Sandy here at Riverside a couple of years back on viral capsid self-assembly. So the idea here is to formulate a minimal molecular model of MPPN organization where we do not make some assumption regarding optimal packing, right? So a very, very simple model would be to say that we represent the proteins and the lipid bilayer by disks lying on the surface of a sphere. They have different radii, right, because they have very different sizes. And they interact with each other according to some generic soft matter potential. The details actually turn out to not really matter. And then we can start off in some random configuration and use simulated annealing Monte Carlo simulations to see what, from an energetic perspective, the optimal arrangement of these disks on the sphere would be. Right? And in fact, if we do that, and again, this is a direct analogy to viral capsid symmetry, what we actually find is a snub cube symmetry. And so that way, so, which is indeed what we actually assume in our mean field model, where we assume, right, that for each n, the arrangement of the proteins is dictated by the solutions to the Tamas problem, right? And so that way we can at least sort of check some of these assumptions that go into the mean field model. Okay, so let's go back to thermal effects. So actually what we have to do is to work out the statistical thermodynamics of MPPN self-assembly, right? And this sounds very complicated, but we're actually saved by experiments here. And what turns out to be true experimentally is that these MPPNs are obtained in a very dilute, in very dilute systems, very dilute in proteins. So at very, very small protein number fractions. I mean, the protein number fraction is one of the knobs they have in experiments, right? And it turns out MPPN self-assembly happens in this regime. So this is actually, from a physical perspective, the relevant regime for us. And in these very dilute solutions, actually, the problem that we have here maps directly onto the self-assembly of amphiphile self-assembly in aqueous solutions. So for instance, the formation of lipid bilayers or micelles in aqueous solutions. Now, the details don't really matter. I just want to point out that this was the physics of that was actually worked out in the 80s and 90s by Bill Galbert, Sam Saffron, and their collaborators. And essentially, all we're dealing with is sort of a fancy version of the ideal gas problem, where we sort of want to work out the mixing entropy in order to construct the equilibrium distribution of different MPPN sizes. And then what we have to do is to minimize the Helmholtz free energy, and then finally end up with the MPPN distribution. So that's denoted by phi of n here. So phi of n is the fraction of all MPPNs having n numbers of proteins. Right, in thermodynamic equilibrium, right, in this very, very simple dilute system here. And again, sort of the only new physical parameter that comes in here is the protein number fraction, okay, which again we actually know from experiments. So putting all of these things together, so in particular using the mean field energy here appearing in the MPPN distribution, we can then finally construct the MPPN self-assembly phase diagram, right? And so the key parameters are, again, the protein number fraction, C, the bilayer protein contact angle, alpha, and the protein radius, the protein size, rho I. And again, we actually know from previous experiments what the values of all of these parameters are, right? In particular, for these experiments in MPPN self-assembly, we live in a region of parameter space that is denoted by this dashed line here. And it turns out that indeed, while a number of different symmetries in general can be generated according to this phase diagram, depending on the values of the various parameters, for the particular values relevant for MSCS and these particular lipids used here, and the particular concentration used here, we actually find that the snub cube symmetry is dominant. Also, it turns out that these snap cube MPPNs have the same radius as observed experimentally, right? And I should really emphasize here that there are no adjustable parameters, right? So we really could have been wrong, right? And in fact, in general, we would have been wrong, right, for other values of these parameters. And so this gives us some confidence that even the simple model sort of captures the basic physics of what is actually going on here. Now, also interestingly, apart from these dominant n equals 24 structures, we also find other types of symmetries, in particular n equals 20, which actually turn out to have a smaller size than the snap cube MPPNs and a much lower order symmetry. And in fact, in experiments, they also find other self-assembled structures which are smaller and have a lower order symmetry. And that's indeed one of the issues at the moment as far as improving the resolution of MPPNs is concerned, because for that one really needs very uniform samples. And so what we're doing at the moment is, in fact, to see whether we can make or suggest possible experimental strategies based on our model as to how one might actually sort of get rid of these competing structures and obtain sort of more uniform samples here. Okay, so this is sort of what I wanted to talk about in terms of MPPN. So what I tried to illustrate was that membrane shape regulation is in general a collective phenomenon, which is manifested for this particular example by the result that if we want to understand MPPN symmetry and size, we cannot just read these off from the structure of an individual protein, but in fact MPPN shape emerges from an interplay between protein-induced lipid bilayer deformations, these sort of global topological defects in protein packing, as well as thermal effects. And it's really all of these things that come together in setting the shape of MPPNs. Okay, so sort of a second topic, I wanted to talk about protein regulation through lipids. Okay, and so the particular model system that I want to talk about here is a membrane protein called MSCL, or mechanosensitive channel of large conductance. So MSCL is a passive ion channel. You're looking here top down onto MSCL. So MSCL, broadly speaking, can exist in two different conformational states, a closed state and an open state, with the competition between these two states governed by membrane tension. From a biological perspective, MSCL has been found in many different types of bacteria, also plant cells. And it is really studied as sort of a paradigm for how cells can sense their mechanical environment, so a paradigm for mechanosensing. Also, for instance, for E. coli, the function of MSCL is thought to be that MSCL protects the bacterium from cell death following rupture of the cell membrane. So the idea is that bacteria such as E. coli have to be able to transition between radically different chemical environments. And so what can happen during hyperosmotic shock is that water rushes into the cell, kind of swelling up the cell. Now, cell membranes can only support some finite amount of tension, and the idea is that MSCL opens up just before the membrane would rupture, so that different ions can actually pass through the cell membrane, and sort of cell death is averted. That's at least sort of the story, but it's still somewhat an open question as to what it is really the whole story, actually. Now, for our purposes, kind of the interesting feature of MSCL is that there's sort of a long tradition of very careful biophysics experiments. So, for instance, what one can do is to remove MSCL from its cell membrane and embed it in an artificial membrane, in an artificial lipid bilayer vesicle. And one can then use techniques such as micropipette experiments to systematically change the pressure or the tension in the membrane, while at the same time monitoring the probability that a given channel is open or closed. And so that way, this has kind of led to gating curves like that in these in vitro experiments, where one finds a particular gating tension of the channel, which in fact, for the membrane composition relevant for the in vivo system, turns out to be a little bit below the rupture tension of the membrane. So indeed, this provides at least some support for this biological picture here. Also, what's interesting is that one can do this experiment then for different membrane compositions. In particular, one can do this for different hydrophobic thicknesses of the lipid bilayer membrane, and one finds these systematic shifts in the gating tension. Okay, so MSCL is a membrane protein that carries out a physical measurement, right? It actually measures membrane tension. And how can we, and in fact, many membrane proteins, perhaps all membrane proteins, are at least to some extent affected by membrane mechanics. Now, to see the reason for that, let's just kind of think about it in very generic terms. So if we just think about a generic ion channel, a generic membrane protein, to perform some biological function, it will generally have to exist in at least two different, more or less stable conformational states. For instance, a closed state and an open state in the case of an ion channel. Right? Now, in general, there is no reason that things like the hydrophobic thickness of the channel is, in fact, the same between these two states. Right, and so if you think about the free energy difference between the open state and the closed state, there's going to be one contribution which has to do with internal protein conformational changes. On the other hand, there's also going to be another contribution which has to do with these protein-induced bilayer deformations in the surrounding lipid bilayer membrane. Right, and this contribution is going to be sensitive to things like membrane tension, and it's also going to be sensitive to things like the hydrophobic thickness of the membrane. Right, so in these previous experiments, what was done was that the lipid bilayer thickness was actually changed. And as you can imagine, if I, for instance, use a lipid bilayer, which has a shorter lipid tail length, meaning it's actually thinner, and say if we assume it would match up perfectly here, then it would effectively have to stretch here, meaning that we would effectively bias the channel into the open state rather than the closed state. Right, and so this sort of led to this general notion of a coupling between protein function and bilayer mechanical properties. So that's a cartoon, right? But in fact, there's a very long tradition going back to the 70s of physicists actually quantifying these sorts of cartoons. And in fact, one can do this at sort of various levels of sophistication. For our purposes, sort of the most basic model is in fact going to be sufficient. And in this model, one thinks about the lipid bilayer as two coupled elastic fields, which I'm calling H plus here and H minus, which describe the positions of the two lipid bilayer leaflets, so the outside leaflet and the inside leaflet. And one thinks about the membrane protein as simply imposing fixed boundary conditions on these fields. Right, so the physical assumption here is that the lipid bilayer is much more flexible than the membrane protein, so the lipid bilayer adapts to whatever the membrane protein shape is. And indeed, this turns out to be a very good assumption for many, many cases. Now, from a mathematical perspective, it's actually more convenient to work not with H plus and H minus, the positions of the two leaflets, but in fact with what is called the midplane deformation field, H, which simply corresponds to the midplane of the lipid bilayer, and the thickness deformation field, U, which corresponds to the deviation of the bilayer thickness from its unperturbed preferred state, which I call 2A here, right? That's sort of the, in the absence of a membrane protein, this would be the thickness of the 2A would be the thickness of the lipid bilayer membrane. And so this is convenient because then it turns out if one works through the elasticity theory that in fact the corresponding energies decouple from each other. So there is a thickness deformation energy and a midplane deformation energy. So the midplane deformation energy is essentially just the Helfrich energy, this famous energy I mentioned before. So this first term, again, is a mean curvature term describing the energy cost of bending deformations. And the second term here corresponds to the coupling of membrane tension to these deformations. So tau is the tension here. The thickness deformation energy has the same sorts of terms, but in addition, it also has this kt term here, which is essentially just a Hookean spring term. Right? Now, the idea then, sort of in this sort of classic approach, is to minimize one or both of these energies. In fact, for MSCL, it turns out that the thickness deformation energy is dominant from an energetic perspective. And to minimize this, subject to, on the one hand, the specific bilayer material properties one is talking about, such as the tension of the lipid bilayer or the bending rigidity. And on the other hand, also subject to proxies for protein conformation, such as the hydrophobic thickness of the membrane protein at the bilayer protein interface. And then one obtains the energy cost of these protein-induced bilayer deformations. Now, to actually make this problem mathematically more tractable, what is very often done here is to, in fact, assume rotational symmetry. So sort of the typical spherical cow approach, right? So you actually assume that you're dealing with membrane proteins that have a conical or a cylindrical shape, or in general, sort of a superposition of the two shapes. But the important point being that there is rotational symmetry. Now, not too surprisingly, perhaps, this actually turns out to be not the case in general. So, I mean, for some membrane proteins, it's a very good approximation. But in particular for MSCL, it's not a good approximation. And in particular, even very simple things such as the oligomeric state or symmetry of MSCL still turn out to be a matter of debate. So the original proposal was that MSCL is a hexamer, so it has six-fold symmetry. In 98, Doug Rees and his group in a seminal paper obtained the first high-resolution structure of MSCL, which turned out to be a pentamer. And then there was much follow-up work over the next 10 years, all sort of based on the premise that MSCL is always a pentamer. So it came as a surprise, I guess, that in 2009, the second high-resolution structure was determined of MSCL, which turned out to be a tetramer, so four-fold symmetry. And so at the moment, there's somewhat of a debate as to what this actually means. So one explanation is that one of these two structures, in particular, it has been proposed the tetrameric structure is, in fact, an artifact of the way these protein crystallography experiments are done. As mentioned at the beginning of the talk, there are various issues associated with that. On the other hand, I think there's also very nice evidence that, in fact, MSCL occurs as a mixture of different oligomeric states in vivo, tetramers, pentamers, and perhaps even hexamers. And so this sort of motivated us to sort of think about this from a physics perspective, from a theory perspective, and to first of all ask, is there a possible role of protein symmetry in MSCL gating? So in other words, if indeed the protein occurs in different symmetries, might there be a functional significance to that? Okay, so to actually address this question, right, we actually need to generalize this sort of classic theory to allow for arbitrary protein symmetries, right? And in fact, this turns out to be not too difficult. One can do it. But it's just very complicated, so I didn't write down the mathematical expressions. But the bottom line is that one can still analytically solve all of these elastic equations to calculate what is called the transition energy. So the transition energy is the energy difference between the open state and the closed state of the channel. And again, we can do this for all the different models of MSCL shape that have been proposed over the years. Now, again, there's a lot going on in this graph here. So this is plotted here as a function of lipid tail length, so about, as a function of hydrophobic thickness of the lipid bilayer membrane. The important point I want to make is that these different colors here correspond to different models for MSCL shape. And what you can see is that if we jump between these different curves, we cover ground in energy, which is comparable to the total lipid bilayer contribution to this transition energy. So the shape of the channels really does seem to matter. Okay? On the other hand, these three data points are in fact experimental estimates for the total transition energy, which of course does not just involve the lipid bilayer membrane, but it also involves contributions due to internal protein conformational changes, right? And I think what's sort of remarkable is that this is plotted here on the same axis, right? It's the same order of magnitude as the lipid bilayer contribution. So what this seems to be saying is that unless there is some strange cancellation of errors going on, that whatever the protein contribution to this free energy difference is, it's not dominant. At first sight, maybe strange, right? Because we're talking about very large conformational changes here. On the other hand, if indeed the biological function of MSCL is to measure membrane tension, I think it also makes sense that this free energy budget is in fact dominated by membrane properties rather than protein properties. Okay, so these are the transition energies. Now we can also, of course, calculate the opening probability. So this is the opening probability of the channel as a function of membrane tension. And again, this is done for all the different shapes of MSCL that have been proposed over the years. And so the bottom line is that we find these systematic shifts in gating tension as we change the oligomeric state and symmetry of the channel. Right, and so what is actually, well, and I should also emphasize that kind of the nice feature of using sort of these very simplified models is that they have no free parameters, right? So we are kind of really looking at an effect here in these shifts in gating tensions that are a direct result of the symmetry of the channel. Now, what this suggests is that if indeed MSCL occurs as a mixture of different oligomeric states in a real cell membrane, a possible biological function for that might be that it actually allows a fine-tuning of the response of the cell to changes in membrane tension, right? So the idea being that not all channels open up at the same critical tension, but they open up at different critical tensions. And in fact, that this is not a completely crazy idea is, I think, illustrated by the fact that MSCL, so this protein we're talking about, is just one member of a more populous family of mechanosensitive ion channels, including MSCS, this protein we talked about before, as well as other channels. And in fact, they're all distinguished by their gating tensions. So there does seem to be some benefit, apparently, to have the staggered responses to changes in membrane tension, and perhaps having different oligomeric states of one protein is sort of part of the story here as well. So this is sort of the idealized scenario of just having a single channel in a membrane, right? But I tried to emphasize at the beginning that, in fact, membranes are in general very crowded with many, many membrane proteins. And so in a way, the more relevant scenario for the in vivo situation is one where we don't just have one channel, mechanosensitive channel, for instance, but in fact, we have many of them. And then if we think about this just from a very generic perspective, if we have two channels which both deform the thickness of the lipid bilayer, right? If they're very far apart from each other, they will both sort of have a more or less independent deformation footprint in the lipid bilayer. On the other hand, if we move them close together, these deformations, these protein-induced bilayer deformations, will start overlapping. And in fact, the overall deformation footprint of the two channels will be reduced, right? So we actually expect attraction, bilayer-mediated interactions between the channels, which lead to the formation of clusters. Now, if one actually does the calculation, it's a bit more complicated than that. I mean, first of all, these interactions don't just depend on the separation between the channels, but also on the orientation and the shape, right? They're inherently directional once we consider a non-trivial shape of the membrane protein. And in fact, it turns out that these interactions are not even monotonic, so there's actually a regime in separation and orientation where the channels repel each other and a regime where they strongly attract each other. But sort of the basic picture, at least, is correct of what I just said. Okay, so that's sort of the expectation based on the theory. Does it really happen? Well, over the last couple of years, Boris Martinak and his group have been doing a series of very nice experiments, both in vitro and on in vivo derived cell membranes, which show that MSCL, these particular proteins, form clusters composed of hundreds of channels. And they were able to show that this clustering is driven by exactly these bilayer thickness mediated interactions that I just mentioned to you. Interestingly, what they found was once the clusters had formed, the response of these clusters of channels was actually the response to changes in membrane tension is, in fact, different than the response of individual isolated channels. In fact, what they found was that it's harder for clusters to open up, to gate. And this can be understood quite simply by just kind of thinking about a very idealized scenario where, say, we have seven channels in this hexagonal lattice, right? And if you think about opening up the channel in the middle, essentially you have to push the other channels out of the way a little bit, right? So you actually need to bring about a large-scale rearrangement of the lattice. If there are these attractive interactions between the channels, there will be some energy cost associated with that, right? And in fact, this was seen in experiments through the existence of what they term an activation barrier. And this activation barrier makes it harder for clusters to open up. It's also interesting to note that from the in vivo perspective, in fact, it turns out the typical number of channels, MSCL channels per E. coli bacterium, say, is surprisingly large. So for this biological picture that I mentioned before, where one thinks about MSCL as sort of rescuing bacteria following osmotic shock, one would expect, based on the typical conductivities of these channels, that about 5 to 10 of MSCL channels are, in fact, sufficient to rescue the bacterium. In fact, one finds that the number of channels in a real cell is actually surprisingly large, so of the order of 300 to 1,400 channels, and also very much dependent on the history of the bacterium, so sort of what the bacterium has been experiencing through its lifetime, or the colony through its lifetime. And so all of this suggests that perhaps there's some role of collective phenomena here, right, in biology. And so what I want to talk about, sort of the last big topic, is then what is actually then the relation between the different observed structures of MSCL, the lattice architecture of these clusters of MSCL, and then finally the collective gating properties of MSCL lattices. Now this actually turns out to be a much harder problem to think about from a theory perspective, because what we need to do is to be able to predict these bilayer-mediated interactions between hundreds of proteins, right, as observed in experiments, there are hundreds of these channels in a given cluster. We want to do this at arbitrary separations and orientations of the proteins. And at the same time, we also want to account for at least the rough shapes of these proteins implied by structural studies. So it actually took us several years to really resolve these issues. But it turns out that one can do this both from a completely analytic and from a completely numerical perspective. So sort of the analytic theory actually allows us to get exact solutions for these interaction potentials, for arbitrary separations and symmetries of the channels. And that's, in fact, based on, again, some very beautiful work going back to the 80s and 90s. On the other hand, we also collaborated with Bill Klug at UCLA to develop sort of a custom-made novel finite element approach that actually allows us to numerically handle these sorts of problems, again, for arbitrarily complicated systems. And of course, if we actually have two independent approaches, right, the beauty is that we can use them to check each other, and indeed, one finds excellent agreement between these exact analytic solutions and these numeric solutions for arbitrary separations, and particularly arbitrarily small separations between proteins and arbitrary orientations. In any case, so given that, we can then actually calculate the energies associated with different lattice architectures, right? And so let's first think about tetrameric MSCL. So I'm just representing here tetrameric MSCL as a square. And this is the energy per tetrameric MSCL as a function of lattice spacing in clusters of tetrameric MSCL for a number of different lattice architectures, in particular honeycomb lattices, square lattices, and hexagonal lattices. And in particular, we consider two different orientations here, so a face-on orientation of neighboring proteins as well as a tip-on orientation. And so there's a lot going on this graph I'm not going to talk about. This in detail, the bottom line is that the minimum energy state, the most favorable arrangement of the proteins is in fact provided by a face-on square lattice. Right? So in other words, there's a very, very straightforward relation between the symmetry and the shape of the channel and the architecture of the cluster of channels. Okay, that's at least a prediction. On the other hand, we know that for pentameric MSCL, it will actually be more complicated. Or we expect it to be more complicated because we know that we're necessarily going to run into some problems if we want to tile a two-dimensional surface with five-fold symmetric objects, right? Now, we can still do the calculation, of course, but what we actually find is that if we consider, for instance, a competition between honeycomb square and hexagonal lattices, this competition is exactly the same as if we just had cylindrical proteins, so perfect rotational symmetry. Even though any two channels have strongly directional interactions, right? In other words, the directionality of the interaction is washed out. And of course, that's very similar to, or in a sense, exactly the same as this idea of frustration of orientational ordering in two-dimensional lattices, which was noted a long time ago, going back to the 80s at least. On the other hand, we can also, again, go back to the 80s, right, to 2D condensed metaphysics. And if we do that, we actually realize that we can do better in terms of energy, or we might be able to do better in terms of minimizing energy if we allow for sort of a trade-off between translational and orientational order in the system, right? If we relax this assumption of perfect translational ordering. And so in particular, if we sort of go through all this literature, what we actually found was that the optimal arrangement seems to be provided by sort of a distorted hexagonal lattice with in which adjacent rows of the proteins are aligned in opposite directions, which was in fact predicted in 1986 by Chris Henley to correspond to the optimal packing of pentagons in two dimensions. Now, our problem is of course very different. So we don't have pentagons; we have these five-fold cloverleaf shapes. Also, more importantly, we don't just have steric constraints, but we have these bilayer-mediated interactions, which are strongly directional, which are non-monotonic. They can be attractive or repulsive. And in fact, they're not even pairwise additive, right? But still, it turns out that at least for pentameric MSCL, we can understand the ground state architecture simply based on these packing considerations. So that's sort of theoretical expectation. Just to illustrate that and to check it, we can do simulated annealing Monte Carlo simulations, where the idea is that we start off at some very high temperature and then cool down the system and sort of let it crystallize into something approximating its minimum energy state. And by doing that, one indeed obtains these like face-on square lattices of tetrameric MSCL and distorted hexagonal lattices, a pentameric MSCL with some alignment, as predicted by Chris Henley. Now, having that, we can then, of course, also ask what happens if you have a mixture of different symmetries, right? And again, there's actually some very good evidence that this really happens in a real cell membrane. And of course, we know that in this case, something has to give, right? Because the lattice symmetries are not commensurate. If we just look at the energy scales here, we expect that the phase on square lattices are more stable. And so indeed, this is what happens. So we obtain still a nice ordering of these phase on square lattices of tetrameric MSCL. While we obtain further distortions in the pentameric arrangement of further distortions of the distorted hexagonal arrangement of pentameric MSCL. So that's a lattice architecture. Now, if we understand that, can we actually make predictions regarding the function, right? Regarding this existence, apparent existence of an activation barrier. Now, I'm kind of getting pretty late, so I'm just gonna I'm not going to go into too much detail here. The important point, or kind of the result, is that if we calculate these activation barriers for the different supramolecular organizations associated with tetrameric and pentameric MSCL, it turns out that for tetrameric MSCL, the activation barrier is always higher. And if one does a simple estimate based on these energy differences, one would expect that for a given change in membrane tension, tetrameric MSCL lattices activate approximately an order of magnitude slower than pentameric MSCL lattices. Also, if we have a situation where some of the channels are in fact open and some of them are closed, right, we can again ask what's the clustering behavior here. And in fact, what we find is that closed and open channels segregate into distinct subclusters. So they still cluster together, but they're segregated. And indeed, this is also what is found in experiments. OK, so to wrap up this part of the talk, which is almost the end, I think, what I kind of tried to illustrate was that membrane proteins can be regulated through an interplay of protein structure, lipid properties, and the protein lattice architecture. And so for MSCL, this particular mechanosensitive ion channel, this is manifested by the 4- and 5-fold symmetric states observed in protein crystallography having characteristic lattice architectures, which then in turn imply distinctive collective gating properties of the whole lattice. Right? OK, so how much time do I actually have left? Like 5 minutes or?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
OK. So to conclude, I just want to say a few words about how these ideas might generalize. And what I want to talk about here is actually a very, very interesting and very nice system, I think, from a physics perspective, which corresponds to chemoreceptor lattices. So chemoreceptors are transmembrane protein. I will tell you in a moment what they actually do. So they're transmembrane proteins. They occur as dimers, but it has been known for a long time that the dimers form trimers of dimers in a cell membrane. And what was discovered a couple of years ago by Grant Jensen over at Caltech was that actually the trimers in turn form beautiful two-dimensional lattices in cell membranes which have the symmetry of a face-on honeycomb lattice. So each trimer has three nearest neighbors with neighboring trimers arranged in a face-on orientation. And what's really beautiful, I think, is that even things, on the one hand, sort of the lattice symmetry, but also quantitative features such as the lattice constant in these honeycomb lattices is conserved not just from one E. coli bacterium to the next, but also between evolutionary very distant species and even archaea. So it's kind of a universal architecture. Now, so that's electron cryotomography. One can also use super-resolution microscopy to study this problem. And what this has shown is that the clustering seems to happen, or seems to be mediated, the clustering of these chemoreceptors seems to be mediated by attractive interactions between between the chemoreceptors. Right? So that's kind of the result here. And so given what I told you about before, right, first of all, we might wonder then what actually drives the nucleation and correct assembly of these clusters. And again, one can do various estimates. In general, they're going to be bilayer-mediated and protein-protein interactions. If one just focuses on the bilayer-mediated interactions, in fact, it turns out that exactly the same bilayer thickness mediated interactions that we thought about before also turn out to be dominant in this system. And so then, as far as the theory is concerned, we're exactly back to the previous case with the only difference that instead of 4- and 5-fold symmetric objects, we actually have 3-fold symmetric objects, right? We actually have trimers now. But again, we can just work through all the theory. We can work out these interaction potentials. And indeed, they turn out to be to strongly favor clustering consistent with experiments. We can think about how they cluster. Turns out that for large separations of the trimers, this phase-zone orientation is most favorable. But then as they approach each other, for large separations, the tip-on orientation is most favorable. As the trimers approach each other, the phase-zone orientation becomes most favorable. And then finally, we can look at the lattice organization. And indeed, it turns out that now, for these trimers, with the geometric properties suggested by electron cryotomography, the phase-on honeycomb lattice is stabilized compared to, for instance, the tip-on honeycomb lattice or even a hexagonal lattice. Right, so that's kind of one aspect of it. The other aspect of it is function, right? So what do these chemoreceptors actually do? Well, so this actually turns out to be a very, very interesting and very well-studied problem from a biophysics perspective. So people have been thinking about this for 30, 40 years. In particular, Howard Berg has done some very, very classic work on that. So essentially, the chemoreceptors act as a nose for E. coli. So they allow bacteria to sense the chemical environment. And the way this is done is that this chemoreceptor dimer presents a binding site towards the outside of the cell where a specific chemical can bind. If the binding event happens, the signal is transmitted into the interior of the cell through a piston-like sliding of one of the transmembrane helices relative to the other helix. And then this kind of kicks off a signaling cascade inside of E. coli, where in turn there are actually many, many interesting physical properties, but we're not going to be too concerned with this here. So we are really going to think about the signaling event. And what's actually really, really interesting here is, I think, that Howard Berg and Viktor Sulcik, in this case, what they actually discovered was that there is strong cooperativity of these chemoreceptors. So on the one hand, each trimer of dimers switches between different signaling states together, so in cooperatively, even if only one dimer of the trimer actually bound the chemical. But then they also found that even neighboring trimers, in particular 6 or 7 or 8 of these trimers, they form what they term the signaling team, which actually switches between different signaling states together, so in a cooperative fashion. Again, even if only one chemical actually bound to the original binding site presented by the chemoreceptor. And so I basically just want to end with a speculation about whether perhaps bilayer trimer interactions play a role in actually mediating these cooperative interactions. So the idea here is a very, very simple one, right? Especially given what I told you before. So if we think about a chemoreceptor lattice, right, two trimers are going to be at a certain fixed separation from each other. Now, if they're in different signaling states, if we take this piston model literally, what we expect is that they have slightly different hydrophobic thicknesses. Right? If they have different hydrophobic thicknesses, this turns out to be a very unfavorable configuration from an energetic perspective. While on the other hand, this configuration, where both trimers are in the same signaling state, is highly favorable. Right? And so this actually gives us, if we again think about the energy difference, this actually gives us a cooperative interaction energy. It makes it favorable for this trimer to switch to a different signaling state, even if it didn't actually originally sense the chemical. Okay, so that's a cartoon. To see whether this really is feasible, we actually have to do the calculation, right? And so again, we are doing this first for the simpler case where we only have a single trimer, right? And we can again calculate this transition energy, so this energy difference between the two signaling states now. And again, we can do this as a function of various membrane properties. So for instance, we find that as one changes the membrane composition, one can again effectively bias the chemoreceptor into different signaling states, which in fact was also previously observed in experiments. From a biological perspective, the more interesting scenario is, of course, the scenario of interacting trimers and lattices. So we can take these electron cryotomography images, right, which actually tell us the arrangement of the trimers, and then ask, given this particular phase on honeycomb lattice architecture, what is the energy difference between the two signaling states, given that 0, 1, 2, or 3 of the nearest neighbors of a given trimer have made this transition into the other signaling state. If we then do the calculation, what we find is that there is a nearest neighbor cooperative interaction energy of the order of about 5 kBT, which in fact turns out to be nicely consistent with the signaling data obtained by Victor Sochik and Howard Berg, which I mentioned before. OK, so with that, I just want to conclude. So what I tried to describe to you here was how many key aspects of cell membrane function, in fact, do not in some straightforward manner, as sort of mandated by the central paradigm of biology, follow from the structure of individual isolated proteins, but rather emerge from the collective properties of protein structure, these lipid bilayer protein interactions, as the supramolecular organization of proteins, as well as the shape, the overall shape of membranes. So we looked at this in three different model systems, MPPNs, MSCL, and chemoreceptors. And in a sense, the take-home message is that we know, of course, from traditional condensed matter physics that collective phenomena are very often robust, right? That's kind of part of what makes them so exciting, that they're very often not too dependent on what's going on at microscopic length scales. Now, similarly, these kind of collective membrane properties are also generally expected to be robust. And in a sense, what physics can really do here for biology is to help in identifying what the key molecular features actually are, so what actually is important as far as the microscopic physics is concerned, and how would one have to modify these key molecular features to bring about a certain kind of change in the collective properties of the system. Okay, so thank you very much. They co-assemble. So actually, the way the experiment is done, of course, so membrane proteins, by definition, don't want to be in a solution, in an aqueous solution by themselves, right? That's why they are actually stabilized in the membrane rather than just pop out, right? And so the way it's actually done is that one extracts the membrane protein from the cell membrane of E. coli or whatever by adding detergents. So these are molecules with a very high affinity for these hydrophobic regions of the membrane protein. And then one puts these protein detergent complex into an aqueous solution so they can actually be dissolved in water. One adds lipids to the system. And at the same time, there are various tricks for actually removing the detergents from the system. And so that way, the lipid vesicles, including the proteins, actually co-assemble them in these aqueous solutions. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, so that's very, very interesting, right? So, so the first thing to note is that if we had no proteins, right, if we just had a lipid bilayer vesicle, there's in fact this classic result, right, coming from Helfrich energy, that there is a fixed energy cost as far as the bending energy is concerned of actually forming a vesicle, right? It's actually very large, it's of the order of hundreds of kBT. Now, if we have a conical membrane protein, it turns out that if the vesicle has the right radius, has the right size, where the particular value of this right radius is determined by the bilayer protein contact angle, so in other words, by how conical the membrane protein is, so if we have these lipids and the proteins, in fact, this energy cost can be zero. So there's actually zero bending energy associated with forming a vesicle. Right? And so actually, at the end of the day, this is what then determines the size of MPPNs. Right? It's kind of there's one specific size of the MPPNs as dictated by how conical the membrane protein is, which actually gives a very favorable curvature energy. Yes, exactly. Yeah, so it's kind of exactly. There's actually, of course, these minimal surfaces, right? These catenoidal shapes, right? So effectively, that's what it is. So you can think about it as a sort of patching together lots of catenoids on the surface of a sphere, And if you do it in exactly the right way, they match up. And the bending energy is essentially zero.
So the fact that they repel each other has an impact on the size?
Yeah, so they repel each other on a planar membrane, right? If you have two conically included on a planar membrane, they repel each other. If you have a curved background geometry, there's a regime where they attract each other and a regime where they repel each other, right? If the curvature gets, if the radius becomes too small, they actually repel each other. If it gets too large, they attract each other. Yes, exactly. I mean, it's a little bit more complicated, right? Because there are other physical effects too, but this curvature deformation seem to be dominant. So it's essentially a very, very fancy electron microscope. So in a way, the idea is very, very old, right? It goes back to the 30s, I guess. But in the last, 10 years, there's really been kind of one breakthrough after the other. So basically, what you do is you take lots and lots and lots of electron microscopy images while tilting the sample. And then from that, with the computing capabilities which we now have, one can then actually reconstruct the three-dimensional shape. That's the basic idea.
Can you do it at low
temperature? So as far as the development of cryo-EM is concerned, there were sort of two big breakthroughs that happened. One is the computing side. The other breakthrough is exactly the low temperature issue. So the really amazing thing is that one actually talks about in vivo electron cryotomography. So people have figured out ways to sort of freeze cells through sort of plunge freezing, where one is very, very confident that one doesn't observe any artifacts, right? Because this is, of course, always the issue, right? So it's under very low temperatures, so one has to freeze. Of course, in the real living cell, the cell is not frozen, right? And so, in fact, this is so good now that we can actually freeze this cell and then actually thaw it again, kind of raise the temperature, and the bacterium just swims off. Yeah? So from that perspective, it's in vivo. Of course, there might still be some artifacts, right? But it's a reversible artifact. Well, yeah, it's robust.
What's the temperature?
Very low, but I can't tell you what exactly very low means.
Huh?
Yeah, so that order, maybe a little bit, yeah. Mm.
I mean,
the
liquid, it's not like
water, because you don't have any density, you know, expansion. Yeah. So, there are various things, right? So they do all sorts of chemical tricks as well, right? So kind of prevent the formation of crystals and so on, right? Which would be really bad for the cell.
Are there unique experiments that can be done at a place like the LCLS
Stanford?
The
free electron laser, right? Yeah, so that's actually the other technique which I mentioned for determining the membrane protein structure, right? Which is actually really, really beautiful, right? And there they kind of have a setup where they, let me see how to explain it. So if we think about lipids, kind of the self-assembly of lipids into sort of larger scale structures in aqueous solution, like one possible outcome is the formation of a cell membrane, like a lipid bilayer vesicle. But depending on how one changes the parameter in the system, one can also obtain sort of other phases in the system, where, for instance, one has some sort of percolating network of tubes within a solution. And so the idea there is to generate a membrane like that, right? Of course, it's not quite like a cell membrane, but it's a little bit like it, to put proteins in. And then one shoots with these free electron lasers and one protein after the other. And I mean, the protein, of course, is like totally destroyed, right? The whole thing is destroyed immediately. Still, kind of the data that comes out of that has been shown to actually be enough to reconstruct the structure of the membrane protein. So that's actually another very exciting way for solving the structure of membrane proteins without doing crystallization.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, exactly. Very, very fast, but very high intensity. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so I didn't, yeah. So, yeah, so actually my group also works a lot on dynamics, and there are many, many, many interesting questions. I didn't talk about it because, I think I already covered too much material. But of course, that's kind of the interesting thing, right? To what extent is something static, and to what extent is it dynamic in biology? At the end of the day, everything is dynamic, and everything is out of equilibrium, right? Of the clusters, for instance? Oh, yeah, yeah, so that's, yes. So that's very interesting, yeah. So we're kind of working on that and kind of find out. So I mean, this in a sense is kind of the ground state, right? It's a zero temperature state. The energy scales are, you know, dozens of kBT, so this gives us some confidence that this can actually occur, right? That we're not totally off. But of course, in reality, we have a finite temperature, and we're gonna get some collective excitations. Also, if you wanna really understand clustering, of course, it's gonna be thermally driven. So we need to think about these things. But what's kind of exciting about that is that using the super resolution light microscopy techniques, one can actually follow the diffusion trajectories of individual membrane proteins within the cell membrane, right? And so there's kind of one can make direct comparisons between a model and this kind of data then at the end of the day.